Well, good morning, church. Hey, will you stand with us this morning? He is risen today. Yes, yes. Hey, today we're going to sing a new song, but there's some familiar pieces to it, okay? And here's my favorite part about it. It's the same message that we've sung for two millennia, which is that God loves us. And today of all days, we have proof of that. Is that right? In the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So let's sing together this morning. Sing, oh precious.
Snow, no other fount I know. I am one. that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
There was a moment when the lights went out, and death had claimed its victory. The King of love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sin. His blood atoned. When final breath and middle was finished, but not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake, and the
Amen. Well, good morning. You may be seated just for a minute. My name's Dave Curry, and I want to welcome you on behalf of Pastor Scott and the rest of the staff and all those who serve here. We are so glad you decided to be with us this morning. This might be your first time, or it might have been a long time since you've been in a church, and so we're so glad you chose to be with us today in the building as well as online. Hey, you know the drill if you've been with us just for a little bit. If you're a first-timer, if you're a first-time guest, if you want to fill this card out, that would be great. We'd love to get to know you. No pressure to do that. But if you would like to get to know just a little bit more about what we do around here, we would love to meet you in the back at the Start Here booth. I'll be back there. Pastor Brittany will be back there. I think Pastor Jay, several of us, and we'll shake your hand and say hello and just get to know you a little bit better. If you've been here, you kind of know the drill. On the back side, you have a place to put prayer requests and what you're thanking God for. We would love for you to do that. You can do that on the QR code as well if you would like to do that. Well, there are lots of things going on in the life of the church. And coming up here in the very near future, our kids' experience this summer. You know, I don't know how many kids we had out here this morning, but a lot of kids and a lot of eggs were picked up, Pastor Scott. It was a great time. Hopefully some of you were able to be at that. So we've got kids' experience coming here in the summer. We want you to know about that. Also this summer will be kids' camps and student camps. So we want you to be aware of that. So if you've got young ones from elementary age on up into high school age, we'd love for you to be a part of that as well. One of the things that we have been doing for quite some time is coming very soon, and it's the Clean Water 5K. How many of you are going to run in that 5K or walk or crawl or push a stroller? I was told this morning, and I won't tell you by who, but I was told this morning that the reason you have kids and have younger kids is so that you don't have to run the race. You can actually push them in a stroller. All right. So next Saturday, this coming Saturday, just 6 days away, is the Clean Water 5K. Now, if you don't know what that is an opportunity for us to get together and have a great time. But really, more importantly, we are digging clean water wells in Africa with the money that is raised from that. And in fact, I want you to know that there is time for you to still register and be a part of that. We would love to have you out for that. It's next this coming Saturday. But what I want to tell you is, as we kind of lean into our giving moment here, I want to tell you something about those clean water wells. When you give to the church here, through that giving, both of your time and your resources, what we do with that is to partner, and one of the ways we do that is through the clean water wells. We have dug 18 wells in Malawi, Africa, with the money raised from that, and another 3 wells have been dug in other parts of the world. We will dig a handful more this year with the proceeds of the Clean Water 5K. We would love for you to be a part of that. Another thing that we do around here and in our partnering is the Living Waters Ministry. Some of you stood right out in front of the building this morning for Living Waters. And here's the thing, 486 families get served every single month. That's 1,742 individuals that don't have the food that they need get served through Living Waters, and because of what you do, because of partnering with us in this. One other thing that we do is Linwood Ministry. Linwood Elementary is one of our ministries that we give to. Every week, you all serve and work with very, very directly 150 of those students. We serve and partner with 75 of the faculty and staff there, and that's all made possible because of your giving. If you came prepared today to give, you kind of know how this works. You can give in the boxes in the back. You can give in online. You can text to give. If this is your first time, there's no pressure. But we do want you to know about our partnerships and the work that we do as we reach out to the city of Wichita. Well, we say these words each and every week together. Will you stand with me and let's say these words to remind us why and who we ultimately give to. Say these words: freely we have received, freely we give. First, loved us and redeemed us by giving with joy. We give with joy today to put God first, love the people He loves, and be a part of redeeming our city in Jesus' name. Now let's continue to worship.
Hey, we've sang the song Lamb a few times together, and I was thinking this week about Revelation chapter 6. And in that passage, John is having this vision, and the elders are speaking to him, and they say, look, a lion. And John looks, and he turns. He doesn't see a lion. He sees a lamb, like one who was slain. And then it reminded me, well, John the Baptist said, look, behold, the Lamb who comes and takes away the sins of the world. And I was just thinking about the character and the nature of God. And the God that we worship is not a God who came to bring the world to heal, right? Everybody thought that. Jesus was coming in. He was riding in on a donkey. They were laying the palm branches down. Yes, conquer the Roman government, Jesus. Yes, free us from our oppression, Jesus. And what does Jesus do? He gets up on a cross and he bleeds for us, for you and for me. Because that's the kind of God we serve, a God who loves us, who forgot his throne. And that God, that Jesus who died on that cross, is resurrected today. And he is worthy of our praise. So let's sing to him this morning.
Suffer for nothing when you shed your blood, every drop was on purpose. What amazing love! I will make my boast in your cross.
Laying every crown at your feet.
Let that be our cry today, church. Sing it one more time. Thank you today that you are worthy. God, we praise you this morning. We have something worth celebrating. God, that death is not the end. Thank you, God, that you love us so deeply, that you came, that you gave up your life, and that you resurrected. God, thank you for this day. We pray you bless it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you remain standing with me out of reverence for the reading of God's word from Matthew 28? After the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.' So they hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples." This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated.
Thank you. Well, I'm thrilled to see you today. My name's Scott. I have the privilege of serving here as lead pastor. I'm so glad you've joined us today on Easter Sunday. I hope you've took your obligatory picture. If you have not taken your obligatory picture, please do that after the service today. We're starting a series today on Easter called Asking for a Friend. Now, let me explain what that's about. We're going to talk about the honest questions and doubts and struggles and issues that people have about faith. What are those questions? I'm going to ask for your feedback at the end of the message about that in a unique way. But I want to talk to you specifically about something today. It's a question. Each week we're going to work with a question, asking for a friend. Here's the question. Can you find hope? Is it possible for you to find hope that doesn't, in the end, disappoint? Can you, in this life, in this present moment, with the difficulties of the world that you live in, can you find a hope that does not disappoint you? Because the human record is, well, you hoped in it, but it does. How do you do that? I'm going to talk to you about the resurrection today and how the resurrection answers that question. Now, just a little bit about us. I know many of you are here often, and some of you haven't been here in a while. Just want to make sure we're on the same page. What we do here every week in this space and time and in this room is we attempt to ask the big questions about life. The philosopher Socrates is famous for saying the unexamined life is not worth living. And so we want to examine life and make sure that we're living according to what's true and accurate about life. And what we're trying to do as a church is we're trying to create a helpful space to do that. Now, listen, just about us, we're as a church, we're not partisan in any way. We're not ideological. We're not political. And if you came looking for a church that would do all of those things, you'll probably be really, really disappointed because that's not about us. What we're trying to do is we're trying to come alongside people and help them to follow Jesus. And our understanding is that when that happens, is that you begin to experience in your life what we call passionate spirituality. You begin to sense there's a God that loves you, and you find out that in return, you were made to love God. That's what you were made for. We want to come alongside you and help you find authentic community, people you can know and be known by, that you can open up to. You can find a small circle of friends who you can go through life with, who are your people. We want to come alongside you and help you find purpose so that you can make a difference in people's lives through your work, so you can make a difference through bringing hope and love and make the world a more just place. We want you to be the kind of person that when you go out into your day in the morning, when you go to work or go to school or wherever it is, if you're retired, whatever it might be, that what you're doing with your life is that you are threading grace and peace into the world. We want to come alongside people and help them do that. And we want to come alongside people and help them experience personal transformation that you're growing. That's the kind of church that we want to be. We want to invite you into, I only have another word for it, but we want to invite you into a deep life, an examined life. And if we can help you in some way in doing those things, we'd love to do that. Now listen, we're not a perfect church because there is not a perfect church. But we are doing our best to love the truth and to practice grace. That's what we're trying to do. So today, about us, today, again, one of the big questions, can you find hope that doesn't in the end disappoint? Now, I get it. You dressed up today. You look great. This is a great looking group. You look fantastic. You've gotten eggs, some of you. I know you're going to take your family picture. But somewhere, in spite of all of our dressing up, when you take away all of the things we use to cover ourselves up, we ask the big questions, don't we? Is there hope? I mean, I'm going through it right now. Is there hope? And I want to talk to you that at the heart of the Easter message, and I want to show you at least the Christian response to that very, very potent heart question through the reality of the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. I want to suggest this to you about the resurrection. I don't know what you think about the resurrection. The resurrection narrative, the story of Jesus rising from the dead, is what I'm going to call a framing story. A framing story. What does that mean? It's a question I'm asking you about the story that you live in. Everybody has, even if they don't use this language, a framing story that we use to make sense of life. We have a narrative that we tell ourselves about what life means and how it works, and we're often blind to that framing story. It could be where you are from. I grew up as a little boy. I was in Africa, Malawi, Africa, where we're building the wells. I was actually born there in that country, and then my parents moved back. They were missionaries, and then moved back, and my dad was a pastor in Omaha, Nebraska. Any Omaha, Nebraska people in here, or just me? Okay, alone by myself. I had this thing, though, that I used to say all the time when someone would come by me, and I just imbibed it because this is what you do in Omaha, Nebraska, like the heart of the Midwest, right? I would, when someone would come by me or I would bump into someone, you know what I would say? I would say, "Ope." "Ope." And I discovered, it's only recently that I discovered that that is only something they say in the Midwest. Did you know this? Are you aware of this? I didn't even know. Like, I thought that's what you said. And I would be, we lived for a little while on the East Coast, and I would say that, and people would look at me like, what is this guy talking about? What's "ope"? What does that even mean? It's a framing story that we're often not aware that we're even carrying with us. So it could be where you're from. Your politics could be your framing story. Make money, that could be your framing. Be a success, that could be your framing story. It could be some message that your parents gave you as a kid and you're trying to live out of. I promise you that you have it. You have a framing story. We live by stories. Now listen, by that I don't mean that we live by myths. I mean that you and I have a narrative that frames reality for us. Politics, that's a framing story. There's a hero, there's a villain. Money, that's a framing story. Where you come from, that's a framing story. John Quincy Adams, one of the early presidents of the United States, he said, "Whoever tells the best story wins." Now, Scripture, the Bible, is a framing story. I don't know how familiar you are with the Scriptures. It's history and law and prophetic critique and poetry and biography. And it functions as a frame around reality. And I don't know what you believe about the Bible, but we don't worship the Bible. We're meant to worship the God the Bible points to. Stephen Sample, who was the president for a couple decades of the University of Southern California, not a believer in any way, he said about the Bible, he said it's one of a handful of what he called super texts that everybody ought to know that frames reality. And so what I want to do this morning is I want to show you a specific frame from it that I think you will resonate with, and I think it might give you a name for the realities of your life. Today's Easter Sunday, and for Christians around the globe, people are ending what we call Holy Week. And Holy Week is the week leading up to the crucifixion of Jesus on Good Friday, and then the resurrection of Jesus on Easter Sunday morning. And I think this functions as a frame, the Holy Week. Like, so on Palm Sunday a week ago, Jesus rode in triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and everybody waved palm branches, and they shouted, Hosanna, which was a political phrase that meant God saves. And everybody believed that Jesus was coming. Jesus was doing what generals did when they came in to announce their win, except he rode on a donkey, not on a horse. Triumph is part of life, isn't it? I mean, good things happen in life. Triumph is part of life. On Monday, Jesus went and famously cleaned out the temple of the people who were making money on the backs of people of faith, and there's a long backstory to all of that, but Jesus took whips and drove the money changers out because people, shockingly, were using religion to abuse people. I know that doesn't happen today and you can't resonate, but it was happening then. And Jesus wasn't having anything to do with it, and so he had conflict and he had confrontation. And as a result of that, the religious leaders and the political leaders colluded together and they plotted to kill Jesus, which they did on Friday. On Thursday, Jesus was with his disciples in the upper room, and one of his disciples, Judas, who had been with him for 3 years and managed the money, didn't agree with what Jesus was doing. In fact, if you don't know this, Judas' name, he was known as Judas Iscariot, which you have to do a little bit of background digging. That's a reference to a type of dagger that the radical nationalists, they were called the Sicarii. The knife was called the Sicarii, and they were the Issachari. And that meant that he was a radical ultra-nationalist. Like if you know the movie by Robert De Niro, who played Sicario, that's a play on this word right here, Judas Iscariot. And Judas quite literally stabbed Jesus in the back. There was betrayal. He experienced betrayal. Have you ever experienced betrayal? For a number of years, I made a massive, massive investment in a person. And after a number of years of just pouring my life into this person, they turned around and betrayed me. It felt like a stab in the back. Have you ever had that? How painful. And then on Friday, we had a service here in the chapel, Good Friday service. It was a crushing loss of hope because Jesus dies on the cross. And you got to put yourself in the place of the disciples who are seeing this for the first time on the very first Good Friday. They don't know Easter's coming. They don't know anything about Easter Sunday. That doesn't mean anything to them. They just know that they had backed this person for 3 years. They'd put all their hopes in this person for 3 years, and then it didn't come true. And they leave on Friday. If you'd ask them on Friday night, can you have a hope that doesn't disappoint? You know what they would say? No. No, you can't. And then Saturday, they waited in despair, and they had no idea again that Sunday was coming. They had the despair of the fact that their world was coming. Was coming to an end. Let me suggest something to you here. I really think this is a great frame for understanding our reality because all of life is found in Holy Week. And here's what we believe. Without a better story, without something that frames it differently, we believe, triumph and conflict and confrontation and betrayal and loss of hope and moments of despair. You know what that is? That's life. Like, that's it. That's what life is. It's all of those, like, highs and terrible lows, and you hope there's more highs than there are lows. Yeah? You've had this, right? You've had great moments of triumph in your life. Maybe you had a baby and all the joy that goes along with that, or you got a great job, or you're doing well financially, or the Chiefs win the Super Bowl, right? Like, you know triumph. But you also know conflicts and confrontation, and there's family drama, or maybe work politics, or there's relational dysfunction. Or maybe you've experienced betrayal, and things didn't go well, and people left you, or maybe you left people. Or there's the loss of hope, and what you thought would work out for you has not. And what was supposed to have happened did not happen, or what was not supposed to happen happened, and you assumed that everybody would always stay, and they didn't, or your kids went away from you, and you've experienced moments of despair. Are you feeling me? Like, this is, without any other frame around reality, all we can say when we look at all of those things is say, well, that's just life. And I just want to tell you that it's all there in Holy Week. Jesus lives it in Holy Week. And so I want to ask you again. What's the story that frames your life? If this is life, the framing story that you're using to make sense of your life, does it give you a way to have hope in the middle of life's story? Is there a mechanism? Is there a hope lever that you can pull? Or do you just settle in? The Apostle Paul, he actually quoted Epicurus, the Epicurean philosophers who are having another moment now. They're coming back. People are reading the Epicurean philosophers again. And he quotes them in 1 Corinthians 5, one of the letters he wrote to the Christians in ancient Turkey. Paul said this about Jesus. He said, if the dead are not raised, and then he quotes here a poet, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Is that it? He says, listen, if that's the framing story and this is life, then hey, let's just make the best of it. Or maybe you would go with Thomas Hobbes, who says life is nasty, brutish, and short. Is that it? Or maybe you go with Shakespeare, who says life is a tale told by an idiot full of sound and fury signifying nothing. Right? I think a picture, this happened in the news, and I always like to try to pay attention to what's happening in the world and use it as an illustration because I'm a pastor, and so I'm always looking for illustrations everywhere. But if you saw in the news, the ship, the dolly that ran into the Francis Scott Key in the Baltimore Harbor, lost power, radioed in, said, hey, we lost power, we don't have any steerage, and crashed into it. This is a picture, isn't it? For most of us, is we've lost power, and now there's a mess, and we're like, uh-oh, what now? And I think that what happens when the framing story is just like, this is it, this is life, that's all that is we take, you and I are like projectors, like a video projector, right? We take what we've been through or what we are going through, and then we project it like out of our life onto the screen of humanity, and then we assume, well, that's it, that's what life's like, that's just how life is, if that's our framing story. Now, I want to suggest to you that the Easter story actually has a mechanism, a frame for saying, wait, there's more than that. The Bible is very, very honest, a very honest book. I don't know if you think the Bible is just this surface book with these little Pollyanna kind of tales. It's not. It's a very, very honest book about life. And when the Bible says that Jesus went on Good Friday, what the gospel writers are saying to you is, they're saying, listen, when Jesus on Good Friday is on the cross, what Jesus is affirming is that, yes, the world is a difficult place. Yes, terrible things do happen. And the cross is a picture that the world, yes, is like that. We can't deny that difficult things happen in life, and it can cause you to lose hope and give in despair. But Jesus on the cross, actually what happened, have you ever thought about this? That this symbol, this Roman symbol of domination and crucifixion, that was a way to squelch resistance and to oppress a people, that was the symbol of death. You would never celebrate someone dying on the cross. Jesus on Good Friday offers his body on the cross, and now it is the universal sign of love and sacrifice. Have you ever thought about how in the world did that transfigure from this symbol of death to now this symbol of hope and life? Well, I'll tell you why. It's a framing story of Easter. Easter Sunday, the resurrection, that's why. It's the only explanation for it. It's the hope lever in the human story. This text tells us that the women came to the tomb. Now, you have to understand something. In that culture, in ancient culture like that, women in that culture were not actually allowed. If there was a crime that was committed and a woman viewed the crime when the court happened, the testimony of the woman was inadmissible in court because women were nothing. Their opinion counted for nothing, didn't matter, was irrelevant. And so if you were trying to write a story about the validity of something that had happened, what you would do is you would never put the women as the testimony of what had happened, because everyone went, women's testimony doesn't matter. In fact, I've got a couple pictures here, one from the second century of this scene from the resurrection and one from the fourth century, the art of what happened. If you were trying to make up a myth or you were trying to spread some kind of propaganda, you would never use a woman. And this speaks to the reliability of the women of the story. Now, you could compare this to other ancient manuscripts. You know the philosopher Plato, you know, a famous philosopher, Greek philosopher. Do you know that from the time that Plato lived until we have the first recorded manuscript of some of his main philosophy, do you know what the gap is? 1,200 years. Do you know how many copies of his writings that we have, it's around, historians say, around 7. So, and everyone's like, yeah, Plato existed, and yeah, all that stuff, Plato's smart, and yeah. Do you know how many manuscripts we have from the New Testament? You know what the gap is from the time the activities of the New Testament that the New Testament writers describe about the life of Jesus and the death of Jesus and the resurrection? Do you know what the gap is? 40 years, written by the people who saw it. Do you know how many manuscripts we have of that? Over 5,000. So 5,000 times they told the story and they said, yes, it was a woman. Yes, it was women that testified. Yes, it was the women. It was the women. And like the early Christians, they were martyred. And you don't get martyred for an idea. Oh, isn't it great? We talked about this a couple weeks ago if you were here. Like the idea that, oh, you know how it is in the winter and then spring comes. And that's what resurrection is, this wonderful idea. No, who's going to offer their life as a martyr for an idea like that? No, you only offer your life if something actually happened. If there's no resurrection, that cross on Good Friday doesn't mean much. It's just another man was killed by an empire on a pile of people that are killed by empires throughout human history. There isn't a hope lever. So if you struggle to believe, I just want to say, wouldn't you want it to have happened? I'm convinced if you do the digging on the history that you'll go, oh yeah, that happened. But even if you can't get there, like, wouldn't you want that? Wouldn't you want a hope lever? If there's a resurrection, here's what that means. Listen, you can have a hope that in the end does not disappoint you. There are disappointments in life. I'm not trying to tell you there's not. You could walk away with what the women that day, I love how Matthew, the gospel writer, says that the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid, yet filled with joy. You'd be like, I don't know, but I got this sense of joy. What if you walked out with that today? Whenever I think about the things that I've lost in life, and I've lost a lot in life, a lot of people, circumstances, I am warmed because I believe in the resurrection. And I'm warmed and I'm redirected by this beautiful line from the Apostles' Creed. You know the Apostles' Creed? It's a statement of faith. It's been said for hundreds of years. There's, at the end of the Apostles' Creed, it says, I believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Why does that redirect me? Why does that warm me? Because it's the framing story. It puts what I'm going through into context. It helps me understand that there's hope. I came across this letter that a dad wrote to his son who was going through some difficulty, and I wanted to read it to you. I thought it was just so good. I thought, man, it would just be good. He talks about a bunch of biblical characters if you're not familiar with them, but this is what he says. Dear son, I continue to pray for you and the struggles you face. I've been so helped as I've thought about some of the following things. I don't want you ever to forget that Moses stuttered and David's armor didn't fit. John Mark was rejected by Paul, and Hosea's wife was a prostitute. These are all biblical characters. And Amos's only training for being a prophet was as a fig tree pruner. Jeremiah the prophet struggled with depression, and Gideon and Thomas doubted, and Jonah ran from God. Abraham failed miserably in lying, and so did his children and his grandchildren. These are real people who had real failures and real struggles and real inadequacies and real inabilities, and God shook the earth with them. It is not so much from our strength that he draws, but from his invincible might shown through the resurrection. I am praying that he will give you courage in this quality of his. I love you, Dad. Some of you, when you came in, you're like, hey, when you get up, the pastor's supposed to say it, and Nathan did a version of it, but you're supposed to say that thing where you say, he's risen, and you haven't done that yet. Well, I wanted to save it to the end, because it's the hope lever. It's the framing story around your life. And so we have this practice where we'll say, I'll say, he is risen, and then your response back, he is risen indeed. Are you ready to do that on Easter Sunday 2024? If you need hope, this is for you. Ready? He is risen. You're going to hear some stories now. We're going to baptize a few folks, and you're going to hear their story of their resurrection, their new life that's been given to them through the power of the resurrected Jesus who died on the cross for their sins. And you'll hear some of their stories. And we always do this every time, and every now and again somebody says, hey, I'd like to do that. And I just always want to say, listen, if you were here this morning and you need a new start, you need a fresh start, you are welcome. You can come down and we'll give you a towel over here. You can just wait in line over there. You can come in and you can come up in the baptistry and I'll baptize you. And you go, well, I'll go home wet. And I say this every time. I said, yeah, you'll go home wet, but you'll go home clean, full of hope. So if you want to do that, great. That's great. If not, that's, you know, hey, stick around and baptism's in your future. But this is a symbol of dying to the way it used to be and rising again. It's just like when you get in the shower and you're full of dirt, you don't know how to get the dirt off. And what the water does, it cleans you, right? It's the power of God to clean a person. It's the grace of God that cleans a person. And we're going to celebrate that together. And then I've got one thing for you before we go.
This is Nolan Bruton. And this is his story. I have gone to church my whole life, and to this church for most of it. God has always been a part of my life. I have known Jesus was in my heart and part of who I am since I was really little. I decided that now is a good time to show my faith to others. This is Nolan's dad, Jason Bruton. I want you to hear his story. I've been wanting to get baptized for a while now. When my oldest, Nolan, said he wanted to get baptized, I felt like that was God's nudge for me. God's plan for my life is greater than what I currently understand, but putting that faith in Him is what He wants for us. God's leading me to be a better man and follower of Christ. I can't wait for what's in store for the next part of my life. Thank you, God, for everything.
Jason, you know that God's forgiven you, that Jesus has forgiven you for everything in the past, wiped the slate clean, holds nothing in issue whatsoever. And you're ready to live for the rest of your life. Come on, cover your mouth. Come on, my hand here. Baptize you in the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
About a year after my family moved to Wichita. I didn't know what it meant to be baptized. So the reason I did it was that I wanted to see what it was like. As an elementary student, it sounded cool to be baptized in front of the whole church. When I was around 14 years old, I started hanging out with the wrong people who influenced me to make poor decisions. Sometime last year, I began to feel terrible emotions, envy, rejection, and guilt. I felt envious of most of my family. I felt like I was being rejected by the people in my life, and I felt guilty for something that wasn't even my fault. I don't know where these emotions came from, but they were pushing me down so far that they took me to the edge. One day I walked into my bedroom and looked at myself in the mirror, and the person in the mirror didn't look like me. I felt like I was looking at someone completely different. I couldn't take all the emotions. I ran into my room to try and hide myself from everyone. But my mom came into my room and asked me why I looked so sad. All the emotions came flooding out. I broke down crying and told her what I'd been thinking about myself. She pulled me into a tight hug and kept telling me that she loved me, that my family loved me, that God loved me. Over the past year, I've become more active in my small group. When thoughts of doubt enter my mind, I pray, read my Bible, and listen to Christian music. I've learned the true meaning of baptism. And the reason I'm here today is to proclaim that I have asked Jesus to forgive my sins. I know he has always been in my life. He was right there waiting for me to reach out to him. And right now, I'm reaching out to him to embrace me in his arms and call me his child. There's a song that I listen to, and when it comes on the radio, I can't help but sing out loud. It's called Perfectly Love. And my favorite set of lyrics to that song are, "You are not a problem. You are not a mistake. Don't need fixing or solving in the arms of his grace. You're perfectly human, made from the dust. You've got a heart broken and scarred, yet you are perfectly loved."
Before we leave today, I need a little bit of help from you. Is it okay if we have just a little bit of fun for a second? Okay. Some of you are like, well, I'm not sure. I don't know. We're doing this series called Asking for a Friend, and we want to talk about the questions that you have, people in your life have, friends that you have. We want to deal with them in an honest way. And so we want a little bit of input from you. And so what's going to happen is there's going to be a slide behind me here any second now. Yep, there it is. And so you've got two options. You can take out your phone and you can either scan that QR code or you can send that message, Wichita First 875, to the number 22333. And what that's going to do is it's going to put you into a poll. You're going to see the results here in just a second. And from your vantage point, which question makes it hardest for people to believe? A, hasn't science disproved Christianity? B, how can anyone take the Bible seriously? C, the evil and suffering in the world, how could there be a good God who allows it? D, the church is responsible for so much injustice, why are Christians so hypocritical? E, isn't it limiting to believe that there's one true religion? F, how can a loving God send people to hell? Now, when you do the QR code, it'll be a button you can click, but if you text it, you'll get a note back, and then you just hit the letter that you would like to represent you. Some of you are getting it already. If you're non-tech, I want you to take one of those Connect cards, and on the bottom, write the letter, okay? We read paper here. I don't know if you know that. We don't do just digital, we read paper, and do that. And so we're just going to have a little bit of fun with a little bit of music here for just a second while you do that. It might be final time. I don't know. We'll see. This is what happens if you turn Final Jeopardy into a hymn, right here, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be singing the lyrics next week, so you want to make sure you're here. You can continue to respond there. We're going to talk about the largest getters. And if you follow me on social media, Scott Marshall, you can follow me on social media. I'll post that there later today or tomorrow. But we'd love to invite you back. We're going to talk about these things honestly. If you have questions, it is fine to have questions. It's fine to have issues. It's fine to struggle. You can. You're welcome to. We want you here, because we want to help you walk through those questions. And so you're invited back next Sunday. If there's somebody you know that would benefit from that, I invite you to invite them with you. Well, a practice that we have together is we send you out with a good word. And so the folks who are here most of the time know about this. If you'd stand with me, and I will give you a good word, a blessing over your life. And you'll see some folks who are here each week, and they do this. They hold their hands out. And what they're doing is they're saying, oh, I want every drop of that good word spoken over me. And if you're comfortable doing that, great. If you're not, that's fine. You can still receive this blessing as you go. May you know the God of the resurrection, who changes your story, who gives you a new frame, who gives you a lever of hope in your life. You're sent to love that God, to love the people who are made in his image, and to serve them in Jesus' name. Hug somebody you came with. Tell them you love them. Take your picture. Thanks for joining us. Thank you.